books in some form or another have been around for thousands of years. Fiction, nonfiction, comedy, drama, picture books, chapter books, comic books, textbooks, bestsellers, self-published, posthumous unfinished manuscripts, short stories, flash fiction, epics, hardcover, paperback, Kindle, bamboo strips, you name it. Books literally come in all different shapes and sizes. The ocean of literature is so vast that sometimes it's not about the story it tells. Sometimes the physical copy of a book, be it its cover, content, or layout, are memorable in and of itself. From rare texts with only one or two copies in existence, to contemporary novels printed by mainstream publishers. Here are five fascinating books. The Book of Soyga, also titled Aldaria, is an essay which contains mysterious tables written in Latin and was completed sometime during the 1500s. Its topics include astrology, demonology, and magic. Welsh mathematician John Dee owned a copy of it, and he was reported to have been obsessed with the mysterious tables. Dee claimed to have communicated with the archangel Uriel about the book. Uriel replied to Dee that the book had been revealed to Adam in paradise by angels and could only be interpreted by the archangel Michael. It was not unusual for Dee to acquire such a unique text, as he understood the value and significance of preserving work. Yet his proposal to Queen Mary to have a library opened in England to archive such documents was never implemented. As a result, Dee accumulated a personal library through his own personal funding, consisting of at least 3,000 printed volumes and manuscripts. Unfortunately, throughout the years, the library would dwindle into nothing, with Dee either needing to sell valuable works in order to survive, while others disappeared due to theft. English astrologer Elias Ashmole recorded that Dee's copy of The Book of Soyga eventually got into the hands of the Duke of Lauderdale. Aside from this copy, there was also a second known manuscript. However, both manuscripts were believed to be lost before the 1700s and would remain that way for about 300 years until, in 1994, Deborah Harkness, a scholar studying the work of John Dee, uncovered the location of the two copies. One was located in the Bodleian Library and the other in the British Library. Each manuscript varied from one another only slightly, with the British Library's version describing itself as Tractatus Astrologico Magicus, Latin for Treatise on Astrological Magic. Aside from Harkness locating the manuscript, historian Jim Reeds was very instrumental in translating portions of the mysterious tables with an algorithm and piecing together how the Book of Soyga found its way into the aforementioned libraries. It's believed that Dee's copy of the manuscript, found at the British Library, had been auctioned off sometime in the late 1600s, while the Bodleian Library was thought to have acquired their copy through a donation back in 1605. In a paper that Jim Reeds wrote, entitled John Dee and the Magic Tables in the Book of Soyga, Reed notes that the book has a tendency to spell certain words backwards, a characteristic of the new Kabbalistic magic which became popular in the 16th century. Although Reed's algorithm helped decipher some of the code words, the actual contents and significance of the tables still remain a mystery to this day. House of Leaves is the best-selling debut novel by American author Mark Z. Danielewski. While the story, or multiple stories if you will, are fascinating on their own, it's the actual layout of this book that makes House of Leaves truly fascinating. The text contains footnote upon footnote, which in turn leads into other footnotes and narratives, each distinguished by different typefaces. While, at other points in the story, certain pages only contain a few words, arranged in a way that forces the reader to have to actually rotate the book in order to read it. By doing this, Danielewski has brilliantly forced onto the reader a similar tension, uneasiness, and claustrophobia felt by the characters within the book. The reader is introduced to Johnny Truant, a tattoo artist who is considering renting an apartment where the previous tenant, a blind elderly man named Zampano, has recently died. In the apartment, Johnny finds an academic study written by Zampano about a documentary entitled The Navidson Record. The film is about Will Navidson, who begins recording his house when he realizes the interior is gradually getting bigger while the exterior is staying the same size. Though only small differences are originally observed by Will, he eventually finds a door in his living room that should lead outside, but the opening is instead an access point to a cold, dark hallway. From there, Will recruits his brother and some colleagues to go on numerous expeditions into this mysterious void. Aside from these three narratives, House of Leaves also contains appendices. One appendix is the Whalestow Letters, which consists of correspondence between Johnny and his mother, Pelafina, who's in a psychiatric hospital. If an example of Kindle's limitations is ever needed, House of Leaves is your poster child. Scottish novelist Irvine Welsh is perhaps best known for his debut novel, Trainspotting, which was adapted into the highly praised film of the same name. His sophomore effort, Marabou Stork Nightmares, received less attention, perhaps for its experimental narrative, which will probably make it impossible to ever adapt faithfully into a movie. Like House of Leaves, this book is one you will not want to read on your Kindle. The plot, or at least some of it, is told in the first person by main character Roy Strang, who's in a coma. Throughout the novel, Roy guides us through hallucinations and memories that eventually lead up to how he got into his comatose state. As if this wasn't trippy enough, the novel has a second narrative, which either interrupts Roy's main narrative or it appears alongside his. It quickly becomes apparent that this narrative is actually dialogue of those visiting Roy while he's in his coma, suggesting that he is actually able to understand them, even though he can't communicate back. Some of this dialogue triggers certain events from Roy's past, which eventually results in both of these narratives colliding into an unforgettable, shocking conclusion. Before we continue to the second half of this video, please make sure to like, subscribe, share, ring the bell, become a patron at my Patreon, and visit my website, www.cwschultz.com, where you can get to know a little more about me, my four published novels, all available at amazon.com, my award-nominated film Watch, excerpts from my upcoming fifth book, Whispering of the Autumn Leaves, and links to my short stories, such as Rooster, which was featured on the NPR-recognized podcast, 7-Minute Stories. The Voynich manuscript is so fascinating that doing a deep dive would take a video of its own, and plenty of people have made feature-length documentaries on this codex, which only scratches the surface on all the research that has gone into it by both professional and amateur cryptographers, as well as American and British codebreakers from World Wars I and II. Carbon dating reveals that it originated sometime between the year 1404 and 1438, perhaps during the Italian Renaissance. Taking its name from Wilfred Voynich, a Polish samogitian book dealer who purchased it in 1912, the official title or any of its other written contents remains unknown because the writing system used has yet to be identified. The book includes foldable pages with cryptic illustrations of stars, plants, a castle, a volcano, and maybe a dragon? Ownership of the Voynich manuscript can be traced back 200 years after its creation to Rudolf II in the 1600s. Both the text and illustrations are characteristics of manuscripts from Europe, so even if the Italian Renaissance theory is incorrect, the origin has still been narrowed down to the continent, which is not as obvious as one would think if the language is completely unknown. According to the 2013 work, Probing the Statistical Properties of Unknown Texts, Applications to the Voynich Manuscript, the pattern of the texts suggests that the Voynich manuscript is indeed written in a natural language as opposed to just random texts, concluding that this all being one big hoax is very unlikely. One theory put forth by Joseph Martin Feeley is that the text is a highly abbreviated shorthand of Latin, not considered acceptable by other scholars at the time, while Feeley proposed that the author of the Voynich manuscript was likely philosopher Roger Bacon in the 13th century. This was debunked because of the carbon dating. However, that doesn't necessarily contradict Feeley's theory that the Voynich manuscript could have still been written in an abbreviated Latin shorthand, but just by someone else between the years 1404 and 1438. Perhaps a bigger question than what does this text say is, why was it written this way? Was the author writing in code to hide something, or was this done in a language that has gone undiscovered by today's scholars? Regardless, the answer will be fascinating whenever we find it. Shot that any of these five fascinating books will ever be adapted into a movie, James Ponsold's 2015 drama, The End of the Tour, is quite an enjoyable and rewarding cinematic epilogue of sorts to anyone who has the prestige of claiming they've completed Infinite Jest by David Foster Wallace. Coming in at 1,104 pages, or 543,709 words for those of us who have to pitch their manuscript to publishers, Infinite Jest is one of the longest works ever printed, being categorized as an encyclopedic novel. Like House of Leaves and its abundant use of footnotes, Infinite Jest does something similar with its experimental use of endnotes, 388 to be exact, some of which have endnotes of their own. Though there are several different stories of several different characters over the course of several different years, all of these years have been subsidized by specific corporate sponsors, such as the Year of the Whopper or Year of the Trial Size Dove Bar. The main focus is on two characters, Don Gately and Howling Condenza. The former is a recovering Demerol addict and counselor in residence at the Ennett Drug and Alcohol Recovery House. The latter is a tennis prodigy who lives at the Enfield Tennis Academy that was founded by his family. Hal's recently deceased father was also an optics expert and filmmaker who directed a movie called Infinite Jest, a film that is said to be so entertaining that those who view it will lose all interest in anything other than repeatedly watching it and will thus eventually die. Much of the narrative branches out to Hal's older brothers, Oren and Mario, their mother Avril and Uncle Charles, as well as the recovering addicts that Gately helps care for at the Ennett House. Dense, confusing, and random, Infinite Jest is the late David Foster Wallace's magnum opus, which takes its time bringing to life a near-future dystopia that's so consumed by entertainment and escapism that the people within this tale put higher value on their amusement, even at the risk of their own health and well-being. At times boring, at other times exciting, with both subtle and not so subtle comparisons of entertainment being a type of drug, even nearly a quarter century old as of this video's making, it was like David Foster Wallace foresaw the drawbacks of on-demand streaming and the overuse of internet, social media, and video games. Having sold millions of copies worldwide and considered to be one of the greatest novels published in the last century, don't let the praise fool you. Infinite Jest is definitely an exercise in patience, but as painful as it can be to get through, you won't regret the experience once you've finished it. And something like a book sticking with you forever, whether you read it one time or several, that's perhaps more important than being entertained in the moment.